Today we will finish the chiral anomaly part and we will arrive to the formula of Vita Veneziana, and then we will see what the lattice says numerically about the verification of this formula. As I said last time, the Gisbert-Wilson regularization, in particular the Neuberger regularization that is the most used one, was established. Let's say they started in 82 with the Gisbert-Wilson relation, and then at the end of 99 the regularization was established. Okay. Now after that, let's say the relevant step that led to the formula are the following. There is the derivation of the formula within this regularization, and then there is again. And Luscher in 04, there is the demonstration that the susceptibility is finite out of the chiral limit. And then there is the Debye et al. In 04, they produce the computation of the relevant quantity of the susceptibility. And then the other step forward, it's in 10 by Luscher, that were introduced a new definition of the topological susceptibility, which one can prove to be a good one, and this proof is just was done just this today this year. Okay, so these are the milestones for what I'm talking today. So yesterday, what we have seen yesterday is if we define the free energy of the theory as a function of theta, m, and m dagger, this is just defined as the expectation value in absence of theta of e to the I theta q, where q is the number of zero plus minus the number of zero mod minus. And then what we have shown by doing just essentially change of variable within the path integral, what we have shown is that this free energy under a generic transformation, chiral transformation within the path integral, we saw that, for instance, we can write like we can put theta equal to zero if we choose the singlet transformation in proper way, and then the rest is the transformation of the mass, which goes this way here. Okay. In particular, if we restrict to the singlet case, to the singlet rotation, we saw that this is nothing else than saying that this is f of zero, e to the I theta m, e to the minus I theta m. Okay. While instead, if we restrict to the non-singlet transformation, this holds the same. This is the same, except that here we keep theta. V and V dagger will be the non-singlet transformation. Okay, this is the bulk of the last lecture. And now, if you just do derivative with respect to m or to theta and so on, you derive the word identities that I derived last time. And the word identity, the integrated word identity, can be written the first one, the singlet one, can be written like a to the fourth sum over x, q of zero. This is equal to minus m divided number of flavor square, the condensate, plus m square over nf square, a to the fourth x, and then this is the singlet pseudoscalar density. Okay. Then, so this is if you do this, okay, if you derive here and here with respect to theta. Now, if you derive instead here and here with respect to the parameter of the with respect to the epsilon AA, the parameters of the non-singlet axial transformations, what you get instead is that 2m a to the fourth sum over x of p a x. Now this is a, as a clever index, p b 0. This quantity here is delta a b divided number of flavors times the chiral condensate. Okay. Again, q is the topological charge density, p is psi bar gamma phi psi in the continuum, the equivalent of that in the continuum, and pa psi bar gamma phi ta, it has a flavor matrix inside psi. Okay, and then we saw, we say, okay, we can put together the condensate appear here and here. If we solve for the condensate these two equations, okay, in the limit where, today we again we will work always in the limit where the mass is proportional to the density, and number of flavors, and number of flavors is nf is equal 5 today. Then if you do that, you put together the two, and then you arrive to an identity. Tells you that this is equal m square a to the fourth sum over x of p I I x p j j x 0, where I is different from j and there is no summation over I and j. Okay, so this is the pseudo scalar density. For instance, if I equal 1, this is up bar gamma 5 up, and if j is equal 2, is down bar gamma 5 down. Okay. Now these were the identities you can derive in this regularization, and are, you know, these are at finite lattice spacing are finite number here, here, and here, so are just mathematical identities. Okay, but they are not very useful when we want to go to the continuum limit, because if you want to do that, each of these terms here is divergent in the continuum limit, and so it's not very useful. The same happen here. So the idea is try to see if it's possible to cook up a combination of to rewrite, in particular, this quantity here, in such a way that we can prove that this quantity is finite. Okay? So it looks like infinite, and actually, if you use a standard discretization of Q, FF tilde, it is divergent. But actually, the goal of today is try to demonstrate that this quantity here is finite by combining word identities of this form. Okay, so the first step of this we already did is the combination of this word identity and this that arrived to the, and you see that here the condensate disappears. Okay, we have just the correlation function of two pseudoscalar densities. Now the condensate, as I say, is divergent in the continuum limit out of the chiral limit. Out of the chiral limit and in the continuum limit. So we are already removed one quantity which is divergent, but unfortunately we are still left with a quantity which is divergent. So now we have to work on this part here to make it to rewrite in such a way that we can prove that actually that quantity is finite. Okay. So we work again in flavor, and we work in the degenerate case. And now we make non-singlet axial transformation. So epsilon AA will be different from zero. For A, let's say 1, 2, and 3. Okay? So A, 1, 2, and 3, this means that in this flavor matrix, which is 5 times 5, here there will be the sigma a 0. Okay, here they will be the Pauli matrices. So we just rotate flavors within the two families only. Okay, now if we do that, what we get is the variation of the action of the Gisbert-Wilson fermion action is minus I minus I a times 2m times the sum, the integral, if you like, in the continuum of p a of x. Okay, and now instead, if we let's consider, we are interested in considering this operator here, S b. So S b is just the scalar density with flavor with the matrix b inside. Again, also b it's a mix B, it's the matrix TB mix the first two flavor on. Now if we do the variation with respect to this transformation of this operator SB, we already did yesterday for the mass term is the same, and this we will get minus epsilon A times psi left the commutator of TA TB, anti-commutator, sorry, of TA TB, psi right, minus psi right, anti-commutator again of TA TB, psi left. Okay, now let's consider the operator now, which is done like this. It's done like the product of this operator here in a point which I will call x2, will be clear in a moment why is x2, times a pseudoscalar density 4, 4. So this is a pseudoscalar density, in our case would be C bar gamma 5 C, okay, of the fourth flavor. And we will put it in a different point, x4, okay? Now, if you do a transformation like this, you see that the transformation flips, rotate only flavor 1 and flavor 2. So the P44 0, okay, because we are not rotating the flavor 4. While we are rotating the flavor SB here, and then we have to compute this anti-commutator here. Now, if you compute the anti-commutator here of sigma A, sigma B, I mean, what you get, you know that the commutator of, let's say, TA, TB, which in the first 2 by 2 part of the matrix, sigma A, sigma B, is nothing else than delta AB divided by 2 of identity. And then here there are zeros. Okay? So this means that if you do here and you explicitate this anti-commutator here, what you get is that the variation of SB x2 is nothing else than minus I A epsilon AA2 of what? Of P11 and P22. Okay, because you have to put that matrix inside here. There is a minus here. And so here there is the pseudoscalar with flavor 1 in x2 plus the pseudoscalar with flavor 2 in x2. Okay? Now we use the four. Is that my apart the prefactor, we get that 2m a to the 4 sum over x is p a x1 sum over x1 s b x2 p 4 4 x4, and then this quantity here is equal to P11 x2 plus P22 x2 plus P4. So you see what we have got here, what got. Now we remember again, now we simply, okay, this is, I guess it's clear what it is. I mean, what I have done here is the variation of the action, which brings down a 2m, the integral of PA. Then there is the operator, which I have chosen to be SB4, okay? And then here what I had to put is the variation of the operator, which is the sum of the two pseudoscalar densities, sum of two pseudoscalar densities, and then there is the one that doesn't rotate, okay, the P44, okay? Now we remember that now this here, when we do the weak contractions by computing this, by doing the fermion integral, what we get is that here we can get just a weak contraction of these two guys, because here there is only flavor 4, while here there is a combination of flavor 1 and 2. Okay, so in particular, this quantity here, when you do the weak contraction, this part, okay, of your correlator is just minus trace of TA TB, and then the weak contraction that yesterday I was drawing like this. Okay. So then so this means that this worded entity here I can rewrite as M A to the 4. Here there is a 1/2 coming from the trace, which cancel these two here. So it's a M A to the 4th X1 of now P12 X1 S21 X2 P44 X4, and this is equal to P11 X2 P44 X4. Okay, this maybe is the most interesting one of all of these worded entities, because you see what I have done here. I just this contraction, instead of writing with flavor B, just say I write this contraction like up bar gamma 5 down, down bar gamma 5 up. Okay, and you will see that there is not this factor in front, and it's just written like this. Okay, now you see what happened here, what we have done with this worded entity here. What we have done here, we started we started with yes. So if you look at the entity rates, okay, from here, from the variation of the operator, here we started with two pseudo-scalar densities of this form, okay, just that I call it 1 and 4, okay? So these are two pseudo-scalar densities disconnected because I have different flavors. And what I have done by doing this rotation is one is left like it is, but doing the rotation in the space 1, 2, I have transformed one of these index 1 in the index 2 by paying the price of putting a scalar density here. So the P11 has been replaced by P12 S21, okay, by doing this rotation here, okay? Now, same trick, and I will not do all the computation, but play exactly the same trick with P44 and playing the trick between the flavor 4 and 5. So what will happen here is this quantity here I can write like P45 times S54, okay? And then I can play again the trick between the flavor 1 and 3, and here I will get S23 and S31, okay? By doing three times altogether this kind of chiral worded entity of transformation. So at the end of the day, I can replace this part of the identity by the following expression. I can replace by this is equal to m to the fifth a to the power 16 x1 x4 of what? Of p12 x1, I will not put all the arguments, okay? S23 S31 times p45 S54. Okay? All these have different arguments, okay? And I put the last one just to zero. Okay, now if you have to remember a formula from all these two lectures on chiral anomaly, this is the formula you have to remember, okay? What is the formula? Okay, let's read the formula. Now you see that we started with divergent quantities, We remove one divergent quantity, which is the condensate, and we were left with only one divergent quantity, the product of two pseudoscalar densities. Then by doing this, what we did, we incremented the number of densities which enter here. And then, if you write the weak contraction of that correlator, the weak contraction, okay, these are two QQ, the gluonic operator, and then this is nothing else up to the m to the fifth, the integral of what? Of what we call the density chains. So there is one with three vertices, one pseudoscalar and two scalars, times the one with two densities, okay? One pseudoscalar and one scalar. If you have more flavors, five is the minimum, but if you have more flavor, you can go on. For instance, here you can add the flavor to six, six to four, and so on, okay? So what you can prove in general, if you have enough number of flavors, that the topological, the integral of QQ can be written as a correlator of two densities, okay? And then the chains depends on how many flavors you have in your theory, okay? For what we need, the five is enough. But if you have more, you can put more. Okay. We will check this formula explicitly by using the eigenvalues properties of the Gisbard-Wilson relation. But I want first to comment on why now this formula is useful and why it solves the problem of the Witten-Venezian relation. It solves the problem because this quantity here now is finite. You can prove immediately that this is finite. Okay. Now, how you do that? Okay, let's suppose that here we don't have the integral, over the coordinates, okay? So you have just a correlation function of two density chains, okay? And all at different points. Then you go in your textbook and you see how these guys renormalize. And since you have exact chiral symmetry, let's suppose that you renormalize your bare quark. You define, you call it Zm times m. Then you will realize that you will see that the scalar density, the singlet or non-singlet, renormalizes with Zs times s, the bare one, and the pseudoscalar one, renormalizes with Zp times p. These are operator dimension 3 and so on, so they just renormalize multiplicative. They are composite operators, so you have to renormalize them. But then chiral symmetry, and this I will not prove, this is quite standard, shows that Zm is equal to 1 over Z. So Zm and Zp are the same because they belong to the same chiral multiplet, okay? And they renormalize in as the inverse of the quark mass. So once you have renormalized the bare parameter in your Lagrange that you have always to do in your action, I mean, also these operators are uniquely renormalized, provided that you multiply by these factors here. So this means here that if you don't have this integral here, you have the product of the fifth power of the mass of the quark. So renormalized like 1 over Zm to the fifth power. But then you have five densities, so the renormalization factor, 1 over Zs, or Zp to the power 5 times Zm to the power 5 cancel out, okay? So if there was no integral here, then this is just a renormalization group invariant quantity, so it's just a normalized quantity. You don't need to do anything there. You just take that quantity and go to the continuum limit, okay? Now, the problem that now arises, and you know well, that when is the integration here, because when you integrate the correlation function in quantum field theory, there are the so-called contact term or Schwinger terms, okay? So this means that you can have short-distance singularities when one of the coordinates, x, goes to one of the other coordinates. And very often, in general, I would say, these short-distance singularities, first of all, they are not universal. So they, in the sense that they do not depend only on the operator which appear here, but they depend also on the particular correlator that you have, okay? So correlator by correlator, you have to decide. It's not enough to renormalize the bare parameter in your theory to say to fix this contact these contact terms, okay, to renormalize this contact term. So first of all, they depend on the correlator, and second, they are divergent. Okay, so now we have to see what in particular this is what happened here if you use the standard, the naive definition. Okay, so now written in that to see how the short distance singularities arise, we can take two of these densities, for instance this one and this one. Okay, so this would say P12 a distance x over s distance zero. Okay, now you do the operator product expansion and you know that x goes to zero, what the operator product expansion tell us, that this has to go, the leading term has to be the operator with the smallest possible dimension with these quantum numbers, and this times a coefficient 1 over x which match the dimension of this operator with the dimension of the operator that you have here. Okay. Now the smallest dimension, since here there are non-trivial flavor quantum numbers, because this here is flavor 1 and 3 do not match. Okay, flavor 2 there is d and d bar. Okay, so this means the lowest dimensional operator with which this guy either can mix or in the operator product expansion can appear here. It is just the pseudoscalar density with flavor 1, 3 in position 0 times, therefore, 1 over x to the power 3. Okay? Because this is a dimension 3 operator, dimension 6 operator. This is a dimension 3 operator, and therefore the power has to be 1 over x to the power cube. Okay? Now, if you do the same naively for qx, we did last time q0, and you take x goes to 0, okay? The operator product, this is a pseudoscalar, has no flavor quantum number, but it's a pseudoscalar. The product of the two is scalar, and therefore, and is dimension 4 and dimension 4. So this can go like 1 over the identity times 1 over x to dimension 8. Okay? So already from here, you see what is the advantage of using this formula here instead of this formula, because the divergences here are much milder than here. Okay. Now what you have to do here, you have to integrate, for instance, in dx here, d for x, 1 over x cube times p 1 3 0. So if you integrate this one, at x different from 0, there is no problem, it's renormalized. Okay. At x going to 0, the operator product expansion would tell you that goes this way here, but this integral now is convergent. Okay. And therefore, this means that these short distance singularities cannot give any divergent contribution to that correlation function. Okay. Now, if you do exactly the same by putting this point close to this close to this, and so on, okay, or putting more than two points together, okay, you will see that there are no short distance singularities that you cannot integrate. Okay. For instance, if you put all of them together, okay, so you have five densities that they go together. In that case, you will see that this will go to 1 over x. This can go to the identity now. And then this will go to 1 over x to the power 15, because this is dimension 5 operator of dimension 3, power 15. But then you have to integrate 4 times over d for x, so it's power 16 in the numerator, and therefore also this one is convergent. Okay? So this means that all possible short distance singularity, the nightmare of the people doing this job, in this particular form in which is written the topological susceptibility are absent. Okay? And so now we can take this quantity here and take the continuum limit of this quantity without caring about any extra renormalization to be done. There are questions? Okay. Now, I didn't show the formula. Sorry, I didn't go through all the demonstrations. So, but let's check the formula by using the spectral properties of the Gisbert-Wilson fermions. And before I erase them, you see that here, this is what I will call later chi, okay? You see also from here that if you take limit m going to 0 of chi from here, then this is equal to 0. The word identity is telling us that the topological susceptibility in full QCD at 0 mass is equal to 0, okay? Because here is multiplied by m times a number, here is multiplied by m squared times a number, and here there is the, in the singlet channel, the eta prime is not a Goldstone pole, so there is no massless particle here, and therefore you can remove it, okay? But even if there was a massless particle here, would be 1 over m times m squared goes away, okay? But there is... Now, let's verify if this formula... Sorry, if this formula makes sense at all from the spectrum point of view of the... So... So we will start with the first of these. So we will start by looking at the topological susceptibility. We say that it is equal to the expectation value, apart the mass factor, the expectation value of P11 times P22, for instance. Okay, is the first of this chain of word identities. Now, if so, we will start by verifying. This formula here. Now remember that the with Gisbert-Wilson fermion, the pseudoscalar density, you can write like flavor 1, if you like the up, 1 minus a bar d divided 2 times flavor 2. Okay? Now this means that when you do the V contraction here, you can V contract here and do the contraction here. And what, so let's call it, sorry for the abuse of notation. This is trace, there is a minus, trace over color and spin of gamma 5, 1 minus a bar d divided by 2. And then there is, here you have to contract psi 2 psi bar 1, which gives the inverse of the Dirac operator in the action. So this is d to the minus 1 m in the point xx. Okay, and the dm in this case is given by d plus m 1 minus a bar d divided 2. Okay. You remember that the mass term in this regularization is gauge field dependent. It's not like in the continuum. Okay, now here, first of all, we can sum over, here we can put y, sum over y, and put 1 over v, and then send the volume to infinity, just by using translational invariance. Here we do the same, and we put 1 over v. So this means here that instead of considering this kind of weak contraction, I can consider sum over x of this. So I can remove here x, I can close it, and put the big trace here. Now the big trace means the full matrix, okay? And then I had to do the product of two of these guys. Now, if you remember, D had three kind of eigenvalues. It had lambda different from zero, lambda bar different from zero, and they were complex eigenvalues. So this was lambda bar was complex, and then was also so that the chirality of the corresponding mode would be zero. Okay? So you see immediately now that the eigenvector of D, so the eigenvector of dm, because this is just a function of D. Here there is a gamma five, since there is a gamma 5, that would mean again the, okay, you define vectors. And then what you get here is the sum of u lambda gamma 5 lambda, which make it 0. So the contribution due to the complex modes to this quantity here is absent. Okay, there is no such a contribution. Then there were modes that were 2 over A and had chirality plus or minus. So we cannot use anymore this argument because these now are chiral modes. Okay? But then if you see here, these modes, D on these modes is 2 over A, so this term is 0, this term is 2 over A, but then this term is 0 again. Okay? So the modes in the far ultraviolet don't contribute again to this trace here. And then, so these, they do not contribute. They do not contribute. Then it, what is left is only lambda bar equal to 0. In lambda bar equal to, forget this coefficient in front here, and forget here the coefficient here. So what is left is dm is m. And so here, this quantity here is what? Is 1 over m minus, there is a minus, 1 over m. And then there is trace of gamma 5 on the modes. And this is nothing else that n plus the number of zero modes minus the number of, sorry, zero mode chirality plus minus the number of zero mode with chirality minus. Okay? So now if you take this and you insert here, you see immediately that you get 1 over m square, which cancel this m, n plus minus n minus to the square, because there are 2 pseudoscalar densities, which is equal to n minus square. That is here. Okay? You remember that the integral of Q is n plus minus n minus. So all this kind of relation, just not like relation between the left and the right hand side. Okay. Okay. Now, how you prove that now if you have this and this is again? So what we should prove is that now is this part, this correlator here, is 1 over m to the 5th power times n plus minus n minus, okay? And this will be one of the exercises, but it's trivial to prove it. And the way to prove it is that what I have done so far here is nothing else than saying that I have the big trace of gamma 5 times a function, a generic function of the Dirac operator D, the massless Dirac operator, okay? And if you see what I have done, this is equal, this function in zero for n values equal to zero, minus the function computed for eigenvalue at 2 over A, times plus minus. So for a generic function of here, there is the zero like we did before. Then there is, remember, times and plus minus and minus. Yes, because there was, yes, there was a minus. Okay. So trace of gamma, it's F0 times and plus minus and minus. And then there is a minus here because the number of zero modes, modes with 2 over A, it's reversed with respect. So n plus minus n minus is equal to minus n plus prime minus n minus prime. Okay, so there is this minus here. And then the function computed at 2 over A. Okay. Now, if you use this and you compute the weak contraction here, you will see that what you get is 1 over m to the 5th times n plus minus n minus square. So you simplify the m to the 5th, and then you get the topological susceptibility. Okay? So all this proves that okay, that this is true. Okay? And in the particular case of a Gisbert-Wilson regularization, this is just an algebraic identity between this side and this side here. Oh, so in particular, at the end of the story, at the end of the story, we can write it here. Chi is nothing else that the number of zero mode with chirality plus minus the number of zero mode with chirality minus square, the expectation value over all the gauge field that you have in your path integral, divided the volume. If you use a Gisbert-Wilson definition for the fermions, okay, or for the topological charge, okay? So you see now this proves a very interesting, this is one of these examples where you have cooked up an observable which is extremely simple to be computed on the lattice, at least in principle. You just have to count the number of zero mode plus and minus, you make the difference, you make the average value of them, and this is exactly what should be connected with the mass of data prime. Okay? This, we will see now how to derive this. Okay? And once you have done this, all this field theory that is behind is telling you that in this particular regularization, this quantity is finite. Means that you take the continuum limit and it has to go to the right value, okay, to the physical value. Now, this formula is somehow even more interesting than that. There is some magic here. And the interesting part it's the following. Is that once you have this, we have derived this formula in the Gispard-Wilson regularization, okay? But now, if you look at the argument that we made to say that this part of the formula is finite, we never used chiral symmetry at that point. Okay, what we used, it's not exact. We use chiral symmetry just to say that Zm is equal to 1 over Zp, that is equal 1 over Zs, okay? Why, to say that there are no short distance singularities, we never use chiral symmetry, because we just say that P12 in X, S23 in 0, goes 1 over X cube, S13 in 0, P1 in 0. Okay? See, by doing this operator expansion, I never use chiral symmetry, I just use flavor symmetry, okay? And the Wilson regularization, for instance, preserves flavor symmetry, okay? So, in saying that here there are no short distance singularities, I can forget to use chiral fermions, so just use the flavor symmetry of the theory to say that there are no short distance singularities. Now, this quantity here can be replaced even in absence of chiral symmetry by defining, okay, this is just for expert, by defining an MPCIC is called, okay, and this quantity here renormalized like 1 over ZP, exactly the inverse of the P that appears here, okay, and also this S, okay, can be cooked up, can be modified so that the quantity that you get here is renormalization group invariant on shell 2, okay, this is needs some massage to do that. So this is just to say that the importance of this formula is not only that it's finite, but also that now we can use this formula here with whatever regularization preserve chiral symmetry, okay? And therefore, this is a universal formula to define the topological susceptibility. If you remember at the beginning I was saying with Wilson fermion it's very, very difficult to deal with the chiral anomaly, okay? Because we break explicitly chiral symmetry. Okay, and in fact we were stuck for many, many years. But now, via the Gisbard-Wilson relation, we found a new definition of the topological susceptibility, that if you have exact chiral symmetry, it's the same as the original one, okay? But if you don't, it's something that you can use, because it's something that is finite, okay? And therefore, if you use now this definition here, or the definition in another regularization, they should all converge, and we will see, to the same continuum limit, okay? So now, this is the formula to remember and to replace in all this paper about the Witten-Veneziano relation to take to have something that you can use in practice in non-perturbative computations. There are questions? Okay, what I show here is in 5-flavor, but I said I'm interested at some point to go to 2-flavor or even to the quench case, okay? Now, I will not provide the demonstration, but just the argument, how you do that. So the argument is the following. What we need to have this density chain is to have an enough number of flavors, in this case is 5, to make it finite, okay? So in whatever number of flavor you have, you can add to your action an action for valence quark, so which is defined like this. Okay, it has a term, so let's suppose that we had two NV, two and V valence quark in your theory. And so the action, this will be exactly like the standard quarks. But then we add to the action, okay, and valence what we call pseudo fermions, which have an action which is just, so these are scalar field. Scalar field with an action done like this. Okay? So essentially they have the same, they have the same operator here, but you do the modulo square of it. Okay? Now this theory is not unitary as a proper expert. I think they don't like it to see it. But for what regard the arguments that we used, so the operator product expansion, so argument that lives in ultraviolet, I mean, unitarity is not relevant. And then you can use now this new theory by enlarging your, let's suppose that we have two real flavors. We can use now, we can add this to the action to have more flavors to play this game here, so to make this density chain and arrive to a finite formula. Okay? So this means that if you define the topological susceptibility this way, or better, this way here, okay, this quantity is finite for any NF. Okay? For any number of flavor, that quantity is finite. Okay? And therefore, now we can play Witten and Veneziano argument, because now we have something that is finite for any number of flavor, including NF equals zero. Okay? Question? Okay. Okay, so what we learned from there is that chi in full QCD, if we have at least one flavor, okay, is equal to zero, okay, for NF different from zero. Then, as you see here, chi, if you don't have fermions, chi is just the number, is the average value of the topological charge square in pure Young and Mills theory. Okay? And there is no reason why chi of Young and Mills be equal to zero. So in general, you expect that chi of Young and Mills is different from zero. I mean, this is, we will see that is the case. But I mean, on generic argument, on general arguments, you expect this. Now, I will not make the theory of large N. But what if you take Toft, then you know that if you take the chi in full QCD, for instance in the chiral limit, this has to be equal to the chi of Young and Mills. If you take naively the Toft limit, you know that adding fermions means to add here something which is, or if you like, 1 over NC. Okay? Whenever you add fermions to a pure gauge theory, the fermions, I mean, makes a null in the diagrams, in the leading diagrams, and this all brings a 1 over NC factor, and therefore, naively, the contribution of the fermions are suppressed like 1 over NC. Okay? So the whole story started from the question that Witten asked and say, now I know that chi of Young and Mills is a quantity of order 1 in NC. Okay, here there are no flavor. Okay, but this is a quantity of order 1 in over NC, in Young-Mills. So the question is the following. Now, if I have a quantity of order 1 over NC, I add fermions that is different from 0, and is mass independent because there are no flavors. And I add a term which is 1 over NC, I mean, the sum of the two, how it's possible that this quantity is equal to 0? Okay, I'm adding some subleading term to a term which is order 1, and this quantity comes out thanks to the word identity to be equal to zero, okay? And now, so one of these things must be wrong, okay? And what is wrong is the naive application of the Toft argument, okay? And now we will see why this is wrong. And correcting by this argument, we will see that the correction is very, very instructive and lead to the formula. Okay. So, now, just an historical comment. I think it's pretty remarkable that these two guys, essentially, they assume all this. Okay, so they assume that, you know, this quantity here, is written in the proper way, not in a naive way. They knew that the naive way was divergent. Of course, it's written in the papers, but somehow they assume that if it's written in the right way, if you like this way, okay, then there are no divergences and you can do all this manipulation. And then this was true. And so I think this is pretty remarkable. So. So now, to make the argument, let's write the topological suscriptibility now as a function of the momenta. Up to now, we were always at zero momenta here. Now, this quantity here is a continuum limit and everything, so I can work now in the continuum limit to make the argument easier. Now, this quantity is d4x, I write, e to the ipx times q of x, Q of zero. Okay, this is just the continuum form of this, but I have injected a momentum there. Okay. Now, this quantity, as I said at the beginning, written like this, can have a quadratic divergence, a quartic, quadratic, and order one. So you can use now the Kalle-Lehmann representation. But to use the Kalle-Lehmann representation, you have to subtract the possible divergences, or in this case, finite contribution that you have at p equals zero. So in particular, this is equal to c0 to the lambda to the fourth plus c1 lambda square p square plus c2 p square square. Okay, and then it starts the standard Kalle-Lehmann representation. And then here we know that there is a pole of theta prime, okay, and then there is the rest, the continuum, if you like, the 3π, from the 3π on spectrum, and I call this from m square to infinity, the density of state here divided t plus p square, sorry, t cube dt. Usually here you don't have this t cube here, you just have, okay, and you don't, here you have a positive sign here. Now the negative sign comes from the fact that q in the Minkowski is an anti-Hermitian operator, okay, so you have to put a minus here. And the fact that here there is a t cube, it's because, try to make as you are used to, like this, but then subtract the contribution at zero momenta, a moment, and put it here. The contribution proportional to p square and proportional to p4. This is what is called a three times subtracted density, and Kalle-Lehmann representation. And then you will see that if you do that, you get a t cube here. Okay. Now, so let's take now the limit where p goes to zero of this quantity chi of p. Okay. Then this will be at p equals zero, we have just shown that the quantity is finite. So this means that the sum of this guy here plus this guy here at p equals zero, here there is no momentum dependence, at p equals zero, this two guys is finite, because that we have shown, okay? And so we take the limit p equals to zero, and this is equal to c0 lambda to the fourth minus r square divided eta prime square. Okay, so this is what is telling us the fact that this is that in this limit that is finite, and just the Kalle-Lehmann representation. Okay, so now we remember that we saw that chi at m equals zero is equal to zero. So this means that R square divided M eta prime square computed at M equals 0, this must be equal to the term, the constant term, lambda to the 4 computed at M equals 0. Okay, this is from here. Okay, now here, so essentially we have used this one up to now. So let's see what this implies. Now, here we do the following limit first. Before doing p equals 0, we do the limit where, so let's look at limit of nf over nc going to 0 of chi of p, where p is different from 0 at the moment, okay? So if we do this limit here, yes. If we do this limit here, all the contribution from the fermions will go away. So in particular, this contribution will go away because R here is suppressed like 1 over nf, okay? Sorry, 1 over nc, this contribution. So what will remain this term, this term, this term, and then will remain the global contribution to this term here, okay? But all the fermion contribution will go away, okay? And then if we take now also the limit p goes to 0, the only things that remains here is c lambda 4 computed in Young and Mills, computed in Young and Mills, okay? It's clear this, because I have removed all the fermions and then I take the limit p goes to 0, okay? Now, so this is nothing else that chi of Young and Mills computed at p equals 0, so what I call chi of Young and Mills. So this is equal to c0 lambda 4 Young and Mills, okay? Now, if I take here the limit now nf over nc going to 0, okay, what I get is that this quantity here has to be to this quantity in that limit, which is chi of Young and Mills, okay? So this means that chi of Young and Mills is equal to the limit nf over nc goes to 0 of r square divided m eta prime square. Okay, then if you have questions, you can have, but I want just to make another step. And then we will see. Okay, I need this. Now just let's see what is R. Okay, R, if you write the word identity that I was showing since the very beginning, but for not the integrated one, you will see that mu is equal to 2nf topological in the massless limit. Okay, there is only this term here. This is an operator, if you like, it's an operator identity, okay? You should put here an operator, and do the calculator, okay? Now, this in particular means, now, if you define, as usual, f eta prime as the matrix element of between vacuum and the pseudo-scalar measure, in this case, eta prime, on the singlet current, usual definition, then you will realize that the expectation value of the density with eta is equal to minus I, there is this I, f eta prime, m eta prime square divided square root of 2nf, okay? Which means, in particular, which r square is f eta prime square m eta prime square divided 2nf, okay? So in that formula, I can replace it and say, so here I replace r square with the f eta prime square m eta prime to the fourth, for the moment I don't simplify, divided 2nf. Okay, now I think it's pretty clear. Okay, then you simplify it and you get f eta prime square m eta prime square divided 2nf. This is the Vitten-Vedenziano formula. So, and I think, I hope is pretty clear now why this was wrong. Okay, why this was wrong? Because in this theory, sorry, we need another step. Sorry. Now I already told you that chi as a function of, as a function on n number of color is order one. Okay. Now it can be proven that f eta prime square is a quantity which is order nc. Okay. So this means this is a quantity one. This is a quantity of order nc, and there is a divided 2nf. This means that m eta prime square has to be a quantity of order nf over nc. Okay? If this has to be a quantity of order 1, this has to be a quantity of order nc square, and there is a 1 over nf. Then here we have to have nf, and here we have to have 1 over nc in the denominator. Okay? So now this way I hope is clear what happened and why, I mean, this argument is wrong or too naive. Okay. It's too naive because when you stay at p equals zero, so the topological susceptibility that we defined since the beginning. Okay. It's true that, you know, all your diagrams, fermion diagram give here, they have a weight which is suppressed like an f over nc. But there is a pole there is a denominator which also is suppressed like an f over nc and makes this contribution order one. Okay? So, this contribution is order one, and full QCD match this contribution to make the topological susceptibility equal zero. Okay? So now one can ask, how can I get such a pole from an expansion? Because this pole is you get because you resum an infinite number of terms of order nf over nc, like think of the geometric series, which makes terms which are order nf over nc square, cube, and so on, a pole. And then when you are in this condition, you resum the series, and this becomes a term of order one. Okay? So you see that from this Patel, Witten was able to derive actually a formula, a very, very interesting formula. Here I can simplify. Okay. Which tells you the following. Okay. It tells you that in the chiral, all this is in the chiral limit. It tells you that in the chiral limit, the topological susceptibility is different from zero in Young and Mills, and it measures the anomalous contribution to the eta prime that you measure in the experiment, of course, in the limit and f over nc. Okay, so up to correction, the leading contribution due to the anomaly in the as an expansion in 1 over nc, if you like. Okay. There is also more in the formula. You see immediately that now, if you send nc goes to infinity, the mass of the eta prime becomes zero, so the eta prime become a Goldstone boson. Okay, and in fact, there is now what is called the large N chiral effective theory, which treat in the large N limit the eta prime like a Goldstone bosons, and all the anomalous correction are inserted as correction 1 over nc and so on. Okay. So in QCD, when you take the limit nc goes to infinity, the anomalous contribution goes away to the eta prime, and you get 9 Goldstone bosons. But in our experiments, we are not in that limit. And this is why the mass of the eta prime is different from the mass of the pions. Okay? Are there questions? Okay, and of course, to make all this argument something like, okay, this quantity has to be finite, okay, otherwise, okay, can, okay, just to give you a flavor, there's a formula, where did I put the formula, okay, what I was saying before is that now what we have to compute is just n plus minus n minus square on our lattice, okay. So this is the only algorithm that I will show in this lectures. So what we need to compute is just this number of zero modes that we get in our configuration of the Gisbert-Wilson-Dirac operator. As I said, in principle it's easy, in practice it's not so easy. Let's say if you take even a small lattice like one Fermi and quite a coarse lattice spacing, you see immediately that this matrix here is order 10,000 elements, and you quickly go to 100,000, and you quickly go to millions of elements. Okay. First, so the algorithm, the standard algorithm that you get in mathematics, for instance, to diagonalize a matrix, goes with the n cube. Okay, where n is the number, is the dimension of the matrix. Okay, so here, if you get 10 to the, this will be 10 to the 15 with respect to let's say a number. So this is completely out of question. I mean, you cannot use standard algorithm. Also, here you want to compute the number of zero modes, and a zero is an exceptional number. Okay, so let's suppose that Mathematica gives you a number which is 10 to the minus 9. Is that a zero mode? Not a zero. I mean, so you have to find a trick to avoid this problem. Okay. And you have to solve these two problems so that you can generate quite a number, you can analyze quite a number of configurations, because the distribution of the topological charge in pure Young-Mills theory, just by it is a Gaussian essentially. And if you compute the error, so, and what you want to compute is the variance of the Gaussian. If you compute the error on the error in the Gaussian, you see that if you want to have 5% error, you need at least 1,000 of configuration to be generated. Okay. So once you have done all this, you are now to find a way to compute these quantities. And the trick is the following. You notice that when you are in finite volume, there are a plethora of arguments telling you that actually you cannot have at the same time chirality modes. Modes with chirality plus and with chirality minus. This is because these modes interact in finite volume, the tail of the modes interact in finite volume, and they immediately become non-zero modes. Okay? This can be checked explicitly even without buying the arguments. Okay? So now, if this is true, then you can do the following. You start from your Wilson operator, the Gisbert-Wilson operator, and you put the projector. Now, these are standard chiral projector, 1 plus or minus gamma 5, here and there, okay? And you define these two operators, D plus and minus. And now, if you do the exercise of taking the complex eigenvalues of the Gisbert-Wilson operator, okay, you will realize that, you remember that we had complex eigenvalues with chirality 0, and they are every time there is lambda, there is also lambda star. For this operator, this means that this operator and this operator here have the same eigenvalues. So the lambda and the lambda star couple split, and one become the eigenvalue of this operator and a real eigenvalue, and this become a real eigenvalue of this other operator here. So these two operators here have spectrum which goes in parallel, except for the zero modes. Okay. So then what you do on your gauge configuration, what you do, you minimize the risk functional, so the quadratic of this operator, and then until in one of the two sectors you find a non, you find that the risk functional, if you implement it in a wise way, you can compute also a bound on the error of the mode that you find. And then what you find, you minimize the risk functional in the two sectors. And at some point, you will find in one of the two sectors a mode, the smallest mode with its error, which is not anymore compatible with zero, okay? Because its error will be smaller like this. And then you say, in this sector, the smallest mode is not a zero mode, okay? Then what you do, you stop there, and then you continue here, and you do the same exercise there. And then once you have done the same exercise, here can happen either that there are no other modes except for this, and then here means that Q is equal to zero, or that, remember that you have always the error on these modes, or that there are zero modes which are far below the bound that you can put here, and then this will be for sure zero mode. You don't need to to be very precise on the modes. You have to be more precise than the error that you make on the low mode. Okay? And then you count how many times this happen in for each configuration. And this gives you the number of the zero modes. Okay? This way you can count exactly the number of zero modes for each configuration with no error. There is no systematic error in this. Okay? Once you have counted that, you make the average of them, and then this gives you the topological susceptibility. So once you do that, you make the square of them, you average, and you compute your topological susceptibility. Now, these are the results by Del Debbie et al. You see, the computation that I was saying before has been done for several lattice spacing. Now, R0 is a typical scale that we use on the lattice to calibrate our lattice, and it's 0.5 Fermi. Its definition is not relevant here, okay? And this theory is a pure gauge theory, and as I said at the beginning, this theory is improved. So the discretization effect should go like A square, okay? And this is the topological susceptibility that is a dimension for quantity times the scale to the 4 power, so that this is a dimensionless quantity, okay? We can go to the continuum limit. So you see that here we start from lattice spacing we arrive, let's say, here up to the square of this, up to roughly 0.05 or so, okay, in the lattice spacing. Now, why there are so these points here? If you remember, in the Gisbard-Wilson relation, there was a parameter that was A bar was 1 A over 1 plus S. And this 1 plus S was the negative mass that we put in the Neuberger definition of the operator. So in summary, what is that by changing S, we are changing the regularization that we use for the topological charge. Okay. What I said is valid for any Gisbard-Wilson regularization, but of course, as I said at the beginning, discretization effect on the lattice are not universal. So you expect that if you change S, discretization will be different. And this is what happened here. So these are the points obtained with roughly 1,000 configuration for S equals 0, okay, with their statistical error. And these are the points that you get at S equals 0.4, okay? And now you see here that now you know from the theory that this has to extrapolate to the same continuum limit. And so if you try independently and then by combining these points, the continuum limit is compatible indeed, okay? While the coefficient of the slope are regularization dependent, okay? Now, if you do that, this is the number that you get in this particular case. And now, if you set the scale by FK in MeV, this is the number that you get. So the topological susceptibility in a Young-Mills theory with NC equal 3 with this scale setting is roughly 185 MeV to the 4 power, okay? And now what you have to do, you have to take the mass of data prime, and then you have to subtract from the mass of data prime the quark mass dependence, okay? And you can subtract it by using what I was saying, large N chiral perturbation theory. So you subtract essentially the small mass dependence that comes from the fact that the mass of the strange in nature and the mass of the up and down are different from zero. And if you do that, this is the number. If you open the paper of Veneziano in 78, this was the number that he was quoting for that number. And so now you see that the number are incompatible within statistical errors. This is even too much, because of course this must be true only up to 1 over NC correction. Okay, and so you would expect that these two numbers should be comparable up to, let's say, 10%. Okay, so I would say that this not only saying that really the bulk of the mass of data prime is given by the anomaly as predicted by Witt and Veneziano, but also that the 1 over NC correction to this formula most likely are very, very small, okay, about the order of few percent in the formula. Now, as I said, in the last 5 years, there were news. And here, okay, these were the points before. And now, as I said from the formula that was here, one can compute also the topological susceptibility by using this chain correlation of chains of pseudoscalar density chains. And this has been done here, even with a large error. And you see that this is compatible within 1.5 sigma of the yellow that is big with the black point that was obtained with the Gisbard-Wilson fermions. And also, Over the last 5 years, we found a new definition. I don't want to enter in this how it's defined. And we recently proved that this definition has to be the same in the continuum limit as the Gisbard-Wilson one. And this definition is numerically much, much cheaper than the one that I was showing before. The green points here, again, are this new definition. Okay? And then you see that if you are, let's say, let's forget this part of the plot. If you are here, you would see a mess. Okay? But then if you use the theory and you say that all this quantity has to go to the same continuum limit, you see that there is a nice agreement within the statistical errors. Okay? And in fact, actually, the most precise now number here comes from this determination here and is this number here, even closer to the number of Veneziana. Okay? But again, this is most likely an accident, but it's indicating that 1 over NC correction are small. So really, the mass of data prime is generated by the leading anomalous contribution. Okay, we can do more, and we can do the following. Okay, we have this F theta that I was defined before. You can do the Fourier transform in theta. And this is what it is. It's nothing else than the topological charge distribution in your Young and Mills vacuum. Okay? So this is nothing else. So what you do is you can measure this because you count, you know, you make an histogram. This is an histogram. And you count how many configurations have topology zero. Here there are 30,000 configurations in this run. And you say, how many have a topology zero? 10,000. Okay. How many have topology minus one and one and so on? And you make an histogram. Okay. And then, as I said at the beginning, you expect that this is a Gaussian. And indeed, if you don't try to make a fit with this high precision, indeed is a Gaussian. Okay. But then, if you try to make a fit, you see here that the Gaussian, okay, deviates from the points that you get. Okay. Deviates here. And then deviates here is not clear, but deviates also here on the tails. Okay? So actually, if you are precise enough, you can see even deviation from the Gaussian. And then, okay, and then now you go and ask Gabriele, you say, now what we do? And then he would say, exactly with the same argumentation that I was making before, and you can make them finite exactly with the same argumentation I was making before. And then you say, if I compute now deviation from Gaussianity, in this case, since there is parity, is the 4 cumulant, what would I expect? So I compute the Q to the 4 connected devices Q square, and then here I expect that this quantity is suppressed like 1 over NC square for n equal 1. Okay? Sorry, for n equal 2. So this is the first correction from Gaussianity that you expect. Instead, if you take a very popular model, the instanton gas model, okay, in the instanton gas, you open the Coleman, for instance, it will tell you, okay, that the free energy will go like cos theta. Okay, we saw already this. Now, if you do that and you do the derivative with respect to theta and you compute this, you would get this ratio to be equal to 1. So these two mechanisms are really different. For the topological susceptibility, this prefactor is a free parameter. So there you cannot say more. But if you go to the 4 cumulant, then here there is a parameter-free prediction. And here you expect something that is of order a tenth, okay? While here you expect something order 1. And now you make the fit of your data, and then you see that if you try the instanton model, you see that it doesn't fit the data, okay? You see here, this is the instanton model. Okay. Well, if you try this one, okay, by putting, unfortunately, a free parameter because we don't know the coefficients here. They don't give the coefficient. It's the red point here, okay, the red curve here. Okay. Now, this here, it's very difficult to see. But here, then what you do is compute this ratio here. So here you compute n plus minus n minus to the 4 power minus 3 times d square. And you divide by q square. Again, as a function of the lattice spacing, and you compute this ratio here, and with Gisbard-Wilson fermion, this is what you got, okay? Unfortunately, here, finite volume effects could not be checked very carefully. So, I mean, here, here was quoted an error that was very large in the continuum limit, essentially not because of the extrapolation, but because the finite volume effect we could check just on a small volume. Now, with the new definition, everything is cheaper, the green point, and then you see that one can be very, very precise here. Okay, and in fact, if you get the continuum limit extrapolation of the green points, you get 0.23 with an error of 5 for this number. Okay, so while the instant on gas is 1 here. Okay, so you see, you can count by yourself how many deviations we are away from the instanton model. Okay, so the instanton model, it was already ruled out by theoretical arguments, but is now is completely ruled out also by numerical experiment, if you like. And so in particular, this means that the anomaly gives the mass of data prime not due to the contribution from the solution from the instanton, means from the solution of the equation of the semi-classical equation of motion, but because the topological charge fluctuates in the vacuum of the Young-Mills theory, and it has non-perturbative quantum fluctuation. Okay, this non-perturbative quantum fluctuation generates this number here, 0.23. Okay, which is compatible with 1/n^2. They would expect 0.1 or something like this. Okay, so a prefactor 2 is okay. I mean, it's not. Okay, thank you.